Hi, everyone. I'm your host, Arlen Schumer, and welcome to one of my pop culture presentations. Get ready to be both educated and entertained, what I call edutainment. And when you're done, please be sure to click the subscribe or follow button on your platform screen to be notified of all of my upcoming pop culture presentations. As much as the superheroes themselves, New York City itself has played a prominent role in the history of American comic art, even if they lived in thinly disguised versions of the city, like Superman's Metropolis or Batman's Gotham. I like the TV show, I don't know about you. Here's how the Gotham City was first named in 1940. We'll go into this later. Also in the 40s, Will Eisner had his New York, but he called it Central City. In the 60s, Marvel Comics actually called the cities they lived in New York City. Ditko's Spider-Man, Jack Kirby's Fantastic Four, Jim Steranko's Captain America. As the 60s gave way to the 70s, Neil Adams' utter realism. As the 70s gave way to the 80s, Frank Miller's Daredevil. In the 80s, we got Ben Catcher to introduce us to Julius Nipple, real estate photographer. In the 90s, Peter Cooper's New York. And in the 21st century, Dean Haskell's New Brooklyn. And yet, the very first American comic strip, appearing in 1895, Richard Outcault's The Yellow Kid, took place in the tenement slums of New York City. So that's what we're here to talk about tonight, ladies and gentlemen. I'm gonna take you back in time and through time for a look at New York City through comic art history. And where does our story begin? Newspaper Row, New York City. And there's an actual photograph of it. That's where the newspaper magnates were at the turn of the 18th into the 19th century. And the giants of Newspaper Row were Joseph Pulitzer on the left of the New York World, and William Randolph Hearst, yes, Citizen Kane himself, of the New York Journal. They dominated New York City journalism at the time. There have been books, there have been documentaries, there have been movies, there have been TV miniseries, I think, about the war between Pulitzer and Hearst. And it came to a peak when this incident happened, when the USS Maine, a United States Navy ship, sank in Havana Harbor, Cuba, in February of 1898. And historians will tell you this contributed to the outbreak of the Spanish-American War. And you can see in these dual front pages how Pulitzer's World and Hearst Journal would have these, you know, intense competition and who can sensationalize the war the most. And this is a, in a sense, political cartoon at the time. And it's written by a critic at the third tier of journalism in New York City, New York Press, in an effort to shame both newspapers' sensationalistic approach. And it was this cartoon that coined the term, at first, yellow kid journalism, and then shortened to yellow journalism. But you might be asking, of course, what is yellow kid? What is this whole look? What is this whole thing about? That's because the yellow kid is considered the first American comic strip appearing in 1895 in Pulitzer's New York Rural. You know, I keep getting them mixed up. And of course, this doesn't look like a comic strip, but you can see that the beginnings of the Yellow Kid were integrated into the newspaper layout itself. And who is the Yellow Kid? Yes, you might be thinking this looks like a birth defect mongoloid child, but this was Richard Outcault's cartoon of the realism of the immigrant children he saw in his day in New York City at the turn of the century. Here's the yellow kid. That was his expression written on his nightshirt. Well, hully gee, here's to you. But we'll talk about his odd appearance in a second. But Richard Outcault, American artist, 1863 to 1928, he starts out working for the newspaper, drawing little lifestyle cuts of life in New York and in a sense in America. But he concentrated on his scenes of New York. And if you look at this nice cartoon of a New York trolley, Outcault wasn't as interested in nice uptown New York as much as he was interested in the downtown tenement slums of the time. Photographs like these, and we've all seen the movies and the recreations of this. Here's a hand-colored, I guess, or early color photograph of those scenes. And it's in these scenes that Outcault would set the strip that would come to be called the Yellow Kid. It didn't start out that way. It was actually called Hogan's Alley, as you can see here. But remember I said, we'll get back to his appearance. Look at the kid first, before he's called the Yellow Kid, before he's yellow. Immigrant children in those days in the slums of New York at the turn of the century, in the first burst of immigration from Eastern Europe and other parts, immigrants were so poor and conditions, there was so much lice that children had their head shaved, and they were so poor they had to use bed sheets and other types of clothing to make makeshift one-piece garments. And they were barefoot because they couldn't afford shoes. So this is a more realistic portrait as it then became this kind of look. And he's called the Yellow Kid at this point early on when whoever was in charge of coloring the newspaper knew that yellow would stand out. And they start coloring Outcault's kid yellow. By the way, they ended up giving him a name. His name was Mickey Dugan, believe it or not. But here is another very early January of 1896 page. Again, it doesn't have the panels, the word balloons of what we call comics. Those will come later. But here are just early examples. September 96, still for Pulitzer's World. And I'll stress that in a minute. But again, look at how Outcault deals with all of this activity and action. So, but again, still not comics per se. But the Yellow Kid was so popular for Pulitzer's World. Look at this advertisement promoting the world via the Yellow Kid. But yet, look at this document, which is Outcault writing to the Library of Congress to secure the rights, as you read here in his script. He wants to copyright the character. Notice the yellow Dugan kid. His name was Mickey Dugan. But why is Outcall doing this in September of 1896? Because he did not own the rights to his own comic strip. This was still so new. So that Hearst of the Journal could literally hire him away and have him do the yellow kid for him. Yet at the same time, because Outcault didn't own the rights, Pulitzer was able to hire somebody else. And for a time, the yellow kid was in both papers. But here's other examples of... Why aren't we advancing? There we go. You can see here in December, oops, we went one too far. Let's go back one. You can see in this example from 1897, we begin to see primitive word balloons. Look in the center to our right of the yellow kid, and that's a dog on the curb with a little word balloon. And I think the cat right next to it has a little word balloon. But the yellow kid still has his trademark sayings on his yellow nightshirt. Now we begin to see the sequential nature of what would be called comics when we begin to see panel divisions and, again, primitive word balloons. Again, not coming from the yellow kid, but coming from the parrot. The yellow kid was so popular for such a brief time that they did collect the comics into what could be considered one of the primitive comic books in the sense of reprinting his comic strip, which is what the original comic books in the early 30s started to do, is reprint newspaper strips. The yellow kid was so popular. Look, he had his own sheet music or something. Yeah, right? But as quickly as the yellow kid burst onto the scene, lasted for a few years, that's also how quickly interest in him died out. But Outcault was able to kind of do okay. He creates Buster Brown, that would become a kind of an American icon in its own right. But it was the yellow kid that kicks off the comic strip, American comic strip medium in a way. Look at this 1926 cover of a trade magazine, Circulation, and the wedding of the comic strip boom that followed in the wake of the yellow kid and comic strips in the 1910s, 20s, 30s. But in the 20s, comic strips were king. You can see in this merging of comics with New York City, beautiful aerial view. Yeah, you don't see the yellow kid there. That's what I mean. He came and he went. But all of this would be a little moot once in 1938, this guy appears on the cover of Action Comics number one. Yes, Superman, which would begin really the wedding of the genre of superheroes with the medium of comics themselves. But for the sake of our topic tonight, I'm most interested in the very first time we see Superman. He is graphically connected to a city skyline. And we have no mention, by the way, at this early stage of the name Metropolis. We'll get to that in a little bit. In fact, their creators, Superman's creators, Jerry Siegel, you can see he was born in Cleveland, and Joe Shuster comes from Toronto. But they lived, I think, a block or away from each other in Cleveland. And that's where this photograph of a commemorative fence post that kind of, encloses the residence of, I believe, Jerry Siegel in Cleveland. They did a nice job there of mounting the first Superman story in Action Comics number one. But you can see early on, he wasn't on the cover of every Action Comics, by the way, until I think the 20s. But Superman is connected to this generic big city landscape. When he gets his own title, because he's so popular in 1939, the summer, and there's a text feature, and you can see another kind of generic cityscape. Remember I said he wasn't on every cover? Well, there's September 39, the same time as Superman 1. And in that issue, we get the first really Superman against a cityscape. But again, it's not named, it's just a generic city. But in this story, in that issue, we hear Clark Kent say, "What's on your mind?" Well, why hasn't the Daily Star done anything about it? Yes, it's not the Daily Planet. That would come later. But it's in that issue that the Daily Star first mentions the name Metropolis. Now, where would writer Siegel, shown at top, and his partner, artist Joe Shuster, get the name Metropolis from? Well, Superman comes out of science fiction backgrounds. These two kids in their teens were science fiction buffs. In fact, their first attempt at Superman is for the first science fiction fanzine, I believe, called The Time Traveler. And I believe the editors were the future DC Comics editors, Julius Schwartz and Mort Weisinger. I might be off on my details here and there, but you can see that Superman is a villain and he looks like the future Lex Luthor. But yes, their first attempt, circa 1933, is this. And then we get the only remaining page of Superman being pitched as a comic book. This is just when comic books are getting started in the early 30s. And it got so many rejections that Schuster ripped up all the other pages. The only one that exists is this very primitive cover. But again, now Superman is an astounding fiction character. He looks like he's flying to the rescue of this poor guy. But again, another generic city background. So the name Metropolis, of course, it comes from the famous Fritz Lang 1927 German expressionist masterpiece. What gave us, of course, the great female robot that becomes the inspiration for C-3PO by George Lucas. But it's these buildings that become really the star of the movie. It's these incredible designs with the elite rich living above the masses below, which would become a recurring motif throughout the 20th century in science fiction. All films that looked ahead to the future, like 1936's Things to Come, based on the H.G. Wells novel about the future. And you can see, again, the masses below and the tiers above. This was carried into architecture in the late 30s, especially at the New York World's Fair of 1939 with the... The triath, something or other, and the perisphere. I'm getting my 1964 World Series, my 1964 World's Fair mixed up with my 1939 World's Fair. But you can see that DC Comics, with their new superstars of Superman and Batman and Robin, they immediately put together a special World's Fair issue that would incorporate the architecture. And the first time a live Superman, the first cosplay of Superman maybe, was this guy in the 1940 World's Fair parade, or maybe 39. The comic was dated 1940. But here's a better version. If you can see Superman's, the boots are like wrestler's boots and, you know, but yes, the trunks go on the outside. But there's that shield with the black background. DC Comics would then have World's Best after the World's Fair comics. Again, the generic city background. World's Best would morph into World's Finest Comics, which is a title that DC publishes to this day. But back to our pal Superman, as we proceed into 1940, we get generic city landscapes again. by Joe Shuster, as well as some ghost artists, as they're called, artists who stay anonymous and work in the style of the known artist. And I think it's this issue in 1940. Got to check my dates. But this is the issue that we get the first actual mention of the name Metropolis with Superman flying above it. And how perfectly timed with what was happening in 1940 when I believe this photograph from the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade shows you how immediately popular, I mean, Superman was a literal overnight success in 1938. So I believe it's the 1940 World's Thanksgiving Parade that he makes his debut. And in 1941, I believe this ad is from, and the pun that he's the biggest thing in shorts is a pun on the fact that a series of animated short films, cartoons of Superman, were debuted in September of 1941. And yes, these are the classic, magnificent Max and Dave Fleischer Studios Superman cartoons. 17 of them made between 41 and 43 that amongst animation aficionados are simply the greatest realistically animated films ever done. They gave us faster than a speeding bullet, more powerful than a locomotive, but especially able to leap tall buildings in a single bound. Now, of course, they don't say, I mean, it's said that this is Metropolis, but everything that the Fleischers did, they were from New York City. They ended up migrating to Florida at the time that they actually created these cartoons, but all of the artists, they were all immigrant, firstborn American immigrants from Jews from Eastern Europe and Russia that make up most of American Jewry in this country. And you can see how this is a total Empire State Building, beautiful drawing, right? Stylized visions of New York City, but it has to be called Metropolis because of the thing. There's the beautiful cell painting, hand-painted cell animation. If you've never seen these cartoons, I think they're on YouTube or whatever, but just get them on. There's a DVD set you just have to have, but this first cartoon had images of Superman in the city that are just some of the most breathtaking pieces of animation art. I mean, the stylization, the curvature of the building, this mixture of realism with stylization. The second cartoon is, I think, the dark horse cult favorite for favorite amongst aficionados of these cartoons, Mechanical Monsters. The inspiration was from the Schuster comics. You can see here, very tin can design for the robots. But the Fleischer cartoon had these characters. Very cool. And in this cartoon, there are some nice shots of the back of the Daily Planet and Superman flying off and giving us these great, again, yes, it's called Metropolis, but these are New York City landscapes. Never was that more so, and I believe the fourth cartoon from 1942, The Arctic Giant. The Arctic Giant, of course, is this giant, you might call it a Godzilla-type prototype. Well, in fact, when the Fleischers are doing this in 1942, their only point of reference is the great King Kong from 1933 as he goes on a rampage through New York City. But the Fleischer Arctic Giant is 15 years before Godzilla, which would, I think, debut in 1956 in Japan. So that's the significance of the Arctic Giant. And in this cartoon, we get some great Art Deco views of the Daily Planet. I love this image of Superman flying out after he changes from Clark Kent. And we get this great little street corner view. Again, all based on New York City landscapes. This could be, I don't know, the Triborough Bridge. Superman flies up with the cable and uses it as a type of lariat and heaves it thousands of yards away past this beautiful Fleischer, New York City, looks like Central Park West landscape, and wraps around the Arctic giant's giant legs, bringing him thundering to the ground. The cartoon, The Bulleteers. By the way, you gotta love these title cards, don't you? They're beautiful hand lettering, but the Bulleteers are the bad guys in this flying bullet car, right? And look how it just goes right into the beautiful Art Deco police headquarters of, yes, Metropolis. But check out this beautiful sequence of images as the bullet car leaves the scene of the crime and the explosions from the police headquarters cast these beautiful primary color tones onto silhouetted buildings that are just, again, maybe this lasts for a couple seconds in screen time. We also get this beautiful aerial view as the bullet car is being chased by Superman through the city. Nice Chrysler building over there, right? But no, it's Metropolis. And again, a beautiful shot of Superman from the Fleischer cartoons hovering over the beautiful cityscape. As Superman moved into the 60s, the baby boomer Superman artist, Kurt Swan, he drew the most archetypal, I believe, Superman. The positions of him flying with the fist in the air and the half-bent knee are just of the type that have such a statuesque, perfect proportion to them that make them iconic. And every future Superman artist is somehow measured against Kurt Swan because of these images. And of course, I'm choosing the ones that have this generic city landscape that Swan would often use as backgrounds for these images. Again, taking place in Superman's Metropolis. But though this might be Metropolis, when Superman revealed Supergirl to the world in 1962, yeah, this is Fifth Avenue, as seen by Kurt Swan, coming down, or no, not Fifth Avenue, Broadway, whatever. But yeah, that's your classic New York City landscape. But, you know, Swan could be realistic for his time. I mean, what makes this absurdist Silver Age Superman so perfect is the utter realism of the buildings and the cars, and Swan taking the time to draw all those people in perfect perspective. And yet Superman, for some reason, and if you've read these Superman comics from this era, early 1960s, you'll know why this was just another day in the life of Superman. And Swan was able to pull it off. Somehow there's a combination of realism and surrealism in this beautiful image. So, like I said, Swan could be realistic, as with this beautifully drawn overhead shot of what is absolutely Park Avenue South below Clark Kent's feet, and Park Avenue North past Grand Central Station down below. And then he could be stylized like this 1967 cover. Maybe my single all-time favorite Kurt Swan Superman cover. And you gotta love that stylized, beautiful, stage-like background. Maybe laid out for Kurt Swan by art director Carmine Infantino, but that's another story. As we move into the 70s, the great Neil Adams gave us this wraparound cover with a nice city landscape. Superman the movie, for its promotional images, shot circa 1977, 78, used New York City's as its photo backdrop. And in retouching, of course, added the Daily Planet in the upper right. Kurt Swan's last issue after drawing Superman for almost 30 years straight was in 1986. And he gave us this nice aerial view of, again, New York City standing in for Metropolis. But DC Comics has since always come back to its Metropolis Superman property. Great artists like Alex Ross continue to pay homage to the early iconic images of Superman. But I mean, come on, folks, that's Superman above New York City at night. Beautiful imagery of Ross paying homage to Schuster's 1939 original. And it was in the year 1939 that, of course, Batman debuted earlier that spring, illustrated by Bob Kane, the only one given credit on the very first page of the very first Batman story. In fact, I believe it might have been the very first issue, or maybe Batman number one, the text piece, would only introduce Bob Kane, the artist, as the creator. The name Bill Finger was never mentioned or credited, but Bill Finger was Bob Kane's writing partner. But, you know, never got credit, and Finger is a story, of course, unto himself. But it's really Finger who gave Batman all of the accoutrements that we have come to associate with Batman. Not only just so many things about the costume, but I want to focus on this idea of Gotham City, because in this early issue of Detective Comics, we see that Batman is jumping across building rooftops through the dark of a New York night. We jump ahead to issue 33. Batman looks like he's jumping off of an overpass on the Long Island expressway, maybe. Notice he also has a gun holster. But what's pertinent to us is that in this issue, again, no mention of Gotham, we have Bruce Wayne walking the crowded streets of downtown Manhattan. And then we got this issue. We're into 1940 now. Yep, hypodermic needle, pre-comics code. And in that issue, Batman trails his quarry again into Chinatown. Now, everybody knows there's a Chinatown in New York. There's a Chinatown in San Francisco. But you can see that when Batman is awarded his own comic in the spring of 1940, he's again, like Superman, immediately wedded to the city, the generic city landscape. But it's in this issue, of course, that the Joker is also introduced, Batman's arch villain, one of the greatest villains in comics. And why is the Joker pertinent to our discussion of New York City and comics? What would New York City's famous Coney Island and the Cyclone there pictured in a maybe hand-colored postcard of the time? Why would this factor into the Joker? Why would Coney Island steeplechase, shown here in the best photograph I could find, and the close-up of the ride at the steeplechase, and what is that bizarre grinning face doing there? What is it on the steeplechase token? What? Are you kidding me? That's the Joker, right? Nope. That's a caricature of the guy that owned the land, George Tillieu. It was his Steeplechase Park in Coney Island. And that was the artist's caricature of him. We don't have a photograph of George Tillieu. But yes, you can see how that had to factor in to the appearance of the Joker, illustrated by Bob Kane in issue one. Of course, along with the ghost artist, Jerry Robinson, who claimed he came up with the Joker and he took it from the playing card. And then you have Bill Finger, who I think supplied Bob Kane with a photograph of the great actor Conrad Veidt. You might know him as the bad guy in Casablanca, who gets shot at the end. But he was in The Man Who Laughs, about a guy named Gwynplaine, who is born with this horrible constricted grin. And also in issue one of Batman, we get the first Catwoman, and that initial costume that wasn't long to survive. But again, a generic city background, not yet named Gotham City. It wouldn't be until the winter of 1940/41, issue four of Batman. I think Batman was a quarterly at first. Under a generic city background cover, we get this story. Nice full page splash by, we assume, Bob Kane, or maybe with some ghosts, maybe Jerry Robinson, who knows. But again, dominant city graphics. Look at how much the city is pictured in this one page. Batman looked pretty cool in those early issues, right? But it's in this issue that we get our first mention of Gotham City, just like in Superman on the newspaper headline. Well, not the headline, the name of the newspaper. And yes, later on in the issue, we get to this page. The next night, two mantle figures are poised against the inky sky that forms the backdrop of the great stage that is called Gotham City. Now, Bill Finger himself went on record as saying, originally, I was going to call Gotham Civic City. And then I tried Capital City. Now, you know, the capital city is used by the Simpsons for whenever they want to designate the big city. And then Finger said, I tried Coast City. Why am I showing you a 1959 Green Lantern? The modern Silver Age Green Lantern took place in Coast City, which was supposed to be the West Coast, like San Francisco. But nevertheless, one of the original ideas that Finger threw out. And then Finger said, I flipped through the New York City phone book. And now this is an actual 1940 issue. So this might have been the actual phone book that he looked through. Now, whether this is the actual ad that he saw, but he said, I spotted the name Gotham Jewelers. Now, this is circa that time period, and said, that's it. Gotham City. So yes, now Gotham Jewelers actually exists or existed in Manhattan. There it is. There's a picture of it. Now, where did the name Gotham then come from? You know, why Gotham for New York City? Well, for that, we've got to go to this guy, Washington Irving. Washington Irving, get this. He was like almost like one of the founding fathers. He lived from 1783 to 1859. He was an American essayist, biographer, historian, diplomat, but he was also a short story writer. Talk about a polymath. And his most famous short stories were, yeah, The Legend of Sleepy Hollow, 1820. And a year before that, Rip Van Winkle, Washington Irving, 1819. But for the purposes of our discussion of where Gotham came from, he was also the editor as well as the publisher. I'm not sure. But Sal Magundi was a kind of like combination humor magazine, political discussion, philosophy, witticisms, a little bit of an almanac type thing. It was an anthology, it was a periodical, and it especially lampooned New York culture and politics. You know, it was like the spy magazine of its day. Spy magazine flourished in the late 80s and 90s. And that's where Vanity Fair comes out of, et cetera. But it was all because Washington Irving wrote a story in an issue of Salmagundi about the village of Gotham in Nottinghamshire in England, which really exists. It's called Gotham. But back then, Gotham came from the Old English for goat home or goat town in Anglo-Saxon. And it had a reputation as a place, according to folklore, occupied, inhabited by fools. And this comes out of a folktale called The Wise Men of Gotham, which Irving took as inspiration to write his modern Salmagundi essay. And The Wise Men of Gotham was about the residents of the English town of Gotham who pretend to be crazy to ward off a visit from the king because they think the king's visit will turn their quiet village into a zoo. This is why so many cities and towns turned down Woodstock in 1969 until Max Yasger gave him the land, because everybody knew it would become a zoo. So this is what made Irving inspired by this, because he said that New Yorkers acted as crazy as the people of Gotham. And it became so entrenched in the 19th century, this idea, that you can see on the sheet music that New Yorkers, whether they knew they were being insulted or praised, they took it to heart and began calling themselves Gotham. And that's why this modern book, a recent winner of the Pulitzer Prize, would still refer to New York City as Gotham. Now, back to Batman, after that initial mention of Gotham, we get some city-themed covers by, again, early Bob Kane and or his ghost artists. In the 50s, I believe this is the ghost artist named, well, there we go. Now, yes, this is Wynn Mortimer, who drew the covers of the Superman and Batman titles for 10 years that straddled the 1940s and the 1950s. So here is a nice Gotham City intersection. Now, Wise Detective Comics number 60, which appeared, I believe, in 1940. I think we're in 1946, maybe, where we get the first mention of, yes, the bat signal coming from the searchlight of the roof of police headquarters. And thus would begin a long-running series of images of Batman and Robin, or Batman alone, responding to the bat signal, always perched against sometimes a very stylized city backdrop. Gotham City, of course. Look at this 1949 issue and how prominent the bat signal is, the silhouette of the city, and even Batman and Robin. Now, the same time this appeared, a couple months later, Will Eisner's The Spirit had this incredible cover. Now, who was the Spirit? What was the Spirit? And why is his vision of, as you can see in the text, Central City, crucial to our discussion of New York City and comics? Well, first of all, here's Will Eisner, young in the 1930s, when he, along with other young budding cartoonists all across New York City and America who want to be comic strip artists, that was where the scene was. Comic books were just getting started in the 30s, and they were reprinting comic strips. But you can see that Eisner had an interest early on with the kind of private eye detective cops and robbers genre. But at the dawn of superheroes, he does a superhero of his own, Wonder Man, and the publisher immediately gets sued by DC Comics, claiming it was infringement. And they won. And that soured Eisner on superheroes. But he was contacted not too long after by the Des Moines Register and Tribune, the newspaper syndicate. And they said, Will, we want to do a comic book sized insert into all of our Sunday newspapers. Would you do it? Would you package it? And would you create one of these newfangled superheroes as the lead feature? Well, Eisner liked the idea of the independence and the money of creating with his studio mates this package, but he didn't want to do a superhero after his bitter experience with Wonder Man. So this is what he gave him. And his only concession when the syndicate said, how is this a superhero? He put a mask on him, that little domino mask there, or whatever you want to call it. But you can see right from the start that Eisner placed the spirit squarely in the streets of the city as Eisner, born in Manhattan, but raised in Brooklyn. But you can see that the spirit by Will Eisner in the 1940s was truly film noir on paper. As you can see, the look and feel of classic film noir cinematic images Eisner was able to achieve on the page. Now, yes, while they were originally in color, many of us spirit aficionados favor the black and white gray toned reprints that Eisner authorized in the early 70s in magazine size format. This story especially looks like a film noir on paper. And that mixture that Eisner patented of realism with cartooniness, like that center panel, is what he was a master of. I mean, you can see, you can feel, you can almost hear what that image looks like if you've ever been in a New York City subway. And that is the power of Eisner's evocative artwork. Look at how he gets the underside of what looks like the BQE, maybe. And how Eisner gets the feeling of wind on a winter night with snow blowing around. That's, again, the mixture of realism with cartooniness. This beautiful aerial shot of the old trolley. And the way, again, you can almost feel the wind billowing the strips of paper making up the spirit logo. You know, modern graffiti artists have attributed Eisner's spirit logos that were intersecting with the city background as inspiration for many of their modern graffiti works. And you can see how they might have been inspired by images like this of the spirit logo acting and intersecting with beautiful city backgrounds, or splash pages, as they're called, or page one. Eisner's first page of his stories had to also function as a comic book cover. And again, it's New York City as he saw it, but, you know, it's called Central City. Just like this image of, again, that mixture of cartooniness with realism, as Eisner does this beautiful overhead shot from Brooklyn Heights, literally. And I mean, at the same time, the realism of this building, down to its, you know, every little brick in detail, functioning as the cover and the first page of the story. I mean, we drooled over images like this. I mean, we could spend a lot of time studying Eisner's beautiful images of the spirit logo interacting with the city from below, from above, from street level. And you can see from an evocative image like this that so many of Eisner's spirit stories centered on these loners, centered on these average everyman, sometimes two-bit hoodlums and thugs, and guys like Gerhard Schnabel, as he called this story, that's considered one of Eisner's greatest. And the city plays such a big part of it. But you can see from page one that Gerhard's not having a good day. He's fired. And he has this dream that he always wanted to fly. And as we move through the story, and Eisner cuts back and forth between a gang of bad guys being chased by the spirit, but that becomes background almost. Because you can see in the middle right panel, Gerhard saying, there's a big crowd below. They'll see me and I'll be famous. And in the bottom panel, he jumps off. And there's Eisner's mastery of realism and cartooniness in one panel. Because those city skyscrapers are just lines on paper, folks, as Robert Crumb once said. And then you turn the page and you get this image, one of the earliest examples of mixing photography with comics, when Eisner takes a New York City photograph, but again, it's Central City. But look at how he graphically has the captions fluttering as we come down to Schnabel reverting to his childhood. Hey, Ma, look at me, I'm flying. And instead of falling, he flew gracefully to Earth. We turn the page, and as Gerhard is flying, he says, gee, it's wonderful, I'm flying, but no one's noticing. And then what happens? He gets hit in a flyby. And so lifeless Gerhard Schnabel fluttered earthward. But do not weep for Schnabel. Rather shed a tear for all mankind. For not one person in the entire crowd that watched his body being carted away knew or even suspected that on this day, Gerhard Schnabel had flown. As we move into the 50s and back into commercial comics, we get this Win Mortimer cover circa 1956, I believe. Nice generic city landscape with the bat signal. Again, the bat shape itself varied over the years. In the 1960s, of course, we get this image of the bat signal. And what would that art be for? Of course, the end credits for the TV series in 1966. And look at how the bat signal and the city image of, again, it's Gotham City, but that is basically Carmine Infantino's sense memory, if not photographic reference, of New York City. Some other Carmine Infantino great covers. This is, I believe, spring of 1967. Great stylized image. And then you get this stylized image of from the fall of 1967, just when Infantino would stop drawing full time and become the first artist to become an executive at DC and eventually publisher. But he made his bones with this guy, the Flash. Yeah, how incredible that the ultimate red-suited superhero would be created and drawn by a guy named Carmine Infantino. But it was his city backgrounds, especially when they were meticulously inked by his soulmate inker partner, Murphy Anderson, as this panel from The Flash is. You can see that Infantino drew a stylized modern city background, but based on his sense memory of New York. But he could also just use the city skyscrapers for pure stylization. Symmetry was a big part of Infantino's look, especially when drawing city backgrounds. Here's another perfectly symmetrical Infantino Anderson cover. Infantino's peers at DC, like Gil Kane, who comes up with the revised Green Lantern in 1959 after Infantino's Flash, is the first Silver Age DC hero to be successful. And again, he's in Coast City, but that looks like downtown New York to me. Joe Kubert's Hawkman from 1961, I believe. That looks like the Lincoln Tunnel. Kubert lived in New Jersey and probably went into the city a lot. And because that looks like the New York City background of this great first Hawkman cover. All the DC characters, none of them took place in New York City. Even though they were all drawn to look like New York City, they took place in generically named cities, like all the ones I think I've just rattled off. But it was in rival Marvel comics, who start a year after the Justice League in 1961. This first issue, created by Jack Kirby in conjunction with Stan Lee, the writer-editor. But you can see that debuting the characters in a city backdrop, but it was called New York City right from the get-go. In fact, their headquarters, called the Baxter Building, was in the heart of New York City right from the get-go. Kirby would take his real-world background from the Lower East Side in New York City growing up on Delancey Street and call it Yancey Street. And that character in the background, in the spring of 66, at the dawn of Kirby's mature style, that would be the Watcher. And again, these beautiful New York City-inspired backgrounds by Kirby. Along with Galactus would be, of course, Kirby's keynote creation, the Silver Surfer. But it was these incredible, imaginative Kirby City backgrounds that looked and felt like New York City, but you can see they're totally made up. They're totally stylized. They're totally beautiful. But that was the magic of Jack Kirby, that he could come up with buildings like this and meticulously inked by his soulmate inker partner, Joe Sinnott. And this would be a double page spread pinup. Kirby did some incredible Fantastic Four covers with the Thing dismantling large chunks of the city. Perhaps Kirby's greatest story from the spring of 1966, This Man, This Monster, which takes place against this beautiful city backdrop. Kirby can make panels like this in which somehow the Thing is balancing an entire crumbling tenement building or some kind of building on his shoulders, and make it all feel and look perfectly right. And then when he wanted to take it off his shoulders, Kirby would make that convincing as well. I mean, the guy that would do incredible scenes of creation did incredible scenes of destruction. Look at this 1990 autobiographical pencil drawing that he does of the Lower East Side that he grew up in. Look at how much it mirrors the photograph I showed you earlier in its colored form, but here in the black and white form. That image was part of a, I don't think ever finished, autobiographical story Kirby did in 1983. I think it was published in 1990, called Street Code. And it's the closest we'll ever get to Kirby autobiography in words and pictures, as he draws the tenement slum interiors that, you know, many families live together and crowded in the tenements of the Lower East Side where he grew up in the early 20th century. And oh, the fights he would have, the carnage at a young adult level. And I mean, if you don't feel the awfulness of the violence that Kirby experienced as a kid. I mean, gangs controlled areas of New York City, and they were all territorial, and they were all ethnic based. There were the Jewish gangs and the Italian gangs and the black gangs. Yeah, just like every movie you've seen. But this is where Kirby would get his future Captain America fight scene intensity and believability from. It was from those childhood fights where you literally fought for your life up on the rooftops and using bricks and garbage can lids as shields. Shields, of course, that's where Captain America got a shield from. Always pictured against the city backdrop. Kirby even set the Avengers with Captain America as their leader. This is the city, he announces. Of course, it's Stan Lee captions and dialogue, but these are Kirby's stories and characters. But again, Avengers was right there on the east side of New York City. Other Kirby creations, August of 62 would feature this cover by Kirby of another one of his signature characters, Thor. And then this cover that he only penciled, he did not create Spider-Man, although he was involved in the early prototypes of Spider-Man. This cover was only penciled by Kirby the same month as that Thor cover, August of 62. But it would be the artist who designed Spider-Man, the great Steve Ditko, shown here from a 1965 page in the Great Spider-Man Annual, where, I mean, those three panels feature three of the most iconic Spider-Man poses ever by his original artist, shown here in an ultra-rare photograph, because Ditko was sort of like the J.D. Salinger / Greta Garbo of comics. But, you know, he hid in plain sight. His studio was on 51st and Broadway for decades. You can go in right there on the directory. It would be Steve Ditko artist. I think it was the third floor. But this is the last panel of the very first Spider-Man story in 1962. It's the size of a postage stamp, but it's the one with great power must come great responsibility. But I love it as an image of Ditko, by Ditko, of New York City, like a German expressionist landscape. Look at this very expressionistic image of a ghostly Spider-Man with his physical alter ego, Peter Parker, or vice versa, against a moody sunset. It was the mood that Ditko injected into his early Spider-Man stories that, again, Stan Lee would dialogue and caption, but I believe they're Ditko's stories. But how he can make you feel an image like this one. Spider-Man, when he first started, was, you know, perceived as a menace, especially when drawn by Ditko like a giant, you know, creature hovering above the city. But it was mostly the antics and derring do of Spider-Man that Ditko was able to capture so perfectly. And I mean, while he was not known for being a realistic artist, so to speak, the realism of Spider-Man's anatomy in these incredible drawings have a realism to them that you can't find in photo reference, folks. You've got to know reality and then know when and when not to distort it for your desired effect. I mean, these, again, are just images out of Ditko's head that just achieve a grace and a beauty and a ballet-like movement, interacting with these beautiful, somewhat generic, yet nevertheless gorgeous city backdrops. This is everybody's personal favorite for the great high contrast lighting. Here's another of Ditko's characters hovering above the city in beautiful chiaroscuro shadows. Who would that cloaked figure be? Who would that tall, stately figure who walks through the streets of the city? who would be that quasi-Asian appearance be who walks past the lamplight right next to the mansion in Greenwich Village? Yes, this mansion exists somewhere in Greenwich Village, and Steve Ditko's memory with that great skylight. Japanese looking, who knows? But that would be Ditko's Doctor Strange, master of the occult, flying above the city with his magic amulet and his cloak of levitation, beautifully drawn in this panel, which is from that 1965 annual, The Great Team Up, every fan's wish fulfillment, where Spider-Man meets Doctor Strange. Maybe the next great Marvel artist to put his stamp on New York City after Ditko would be Jim Steranko in the later 60s. This incredible image from the summer of 1968, the height of psychedelia in the culture at the time. Look at the mixture of photography and graphics that Steranko had been doing for over 2 years before that, with splash pages like this that would merge line art with photographs of New York City. That's Times Square in the background. But that's because, again, the Marvel characters lived in New York. They did not live in made-up generic DC comic cities. Look at this great panel of Nick Fury's apartment. If you've seen Mad Men, you know that this looks like that great New York apartment that he had in the later seasons. Notice the piece of op art on the wall, but check out the photograph that Steranko uses for the city backdrop through the windows of Fury's apartment. Look at these panels Steranko did that merged photography with psychedelic line art. Or how about in this Nick Fury 1968 tale, he uses a paper known as craft tint that you had to use liquid chemicals to bring out the two different line patterns to make these kind of toned illustrations. You can see the different liquids brought out the different concentration of lines. At the same time, Steranko, a master illustrator and graphic designer, really, gives us in 1969 this double page spread of Captain America leaping across what looks like the cross, not the Cross Bronx Expressway, or I'm thinking of something in New York City. No, this looks like right by the United Nations, I think, when you're driving past it on the FDR Drive or something like that. And then you get this famous 1969 splash page that incorporates the city backdrop with this dramatic reveal all on the same page. It felt like literally a film on paper. Steranko, throughout his career after that in the 70s, through his character Chandler, you know, the great film noir private eye archetype, through graphic novels and illustrations, but all based on New York City architecture and graphic signage from the 20th century that Steranko loves. Steranko's contemporary over DC Comics, Neil Adams, would give us in 1970 this incredible splash page of, again, Park Avenue South, going into Grand Central Station at the top of the page, and Adams with his trademark foreshortening and dynamic anatomy. Green Lantern, this was the first issue of his team-up series with Green Arrow that is considered famous. I mean, I do an entire lecture based on this, but suffice to say that for 2 years in a row, it won the equivalent of the comic book Oscars for best continuing feature and best individual story. And Neil Adams' partner, Denny O'Neill, the writer, would get best writer, and Adams would get best artist. That particular cover of the two-part drug story of 1971, that's considered maybe the high point of the 13 issue series that ran for about 2 years between 70 and 72. But this particular issue has an incredible New York City sequence that only Neil Adams, with his realistic acuity, could pull off so beautifully. But as you can see, beautiful splash page sets the scene. Again, when they talk about film on paper, Neil Adams is film on paper because you can feel that night air. You can sense the skylight, the lamppost casting that circle of light so beautifully colored, probably by Adams himself, because he always took the time to color the art that he both penciled and inked. And again, the realism of the buildings that Adams pulled off so beautifully. So you can see Green Arrow's alter ego of Oliver Queen is getting assaulted by these multiracial hoodlums, as you'll notice. But then one of them takes a crossbow and hits him with it. And then Adams gives us this beautifully, almost dialogueless, little crawling tour, I call it, of New York City and the indifference of people to the plight of somebody literally dying on the street. The crumbling late 60s, early 70s of New York City, signified by the phone booth. Remember them, folks, being out of order. The indifference of the cop, well, maybe some things haven't changed, right? When you turn the page, the taxi guy doesn't want to pick him up. Surprise, because at least he's white, right? He staggers into the hospital. The nurse says, "We're very busy tonight. Could you come back in the morning?" And we end with, "Isn't modern civilization wonderful?" Towards the end of the run, in late 71, early 72, we get this story written by young Elliot Magan, who would go on to have a fabulous career as a comic book writer. But this was his first story that he submitted to editor Julia Schwartz. And Schwartz loved it so much, he showed it to Neil Adams, and Adams wanted to illustrate it. And it's about Green Arrow coming upon, by the way, let us not point out, fail to point out, I mean, the beauty of Adams' photorealism in that ghetto shot of the trash cans and the kid and everything about it. I mean, Neil Adams is a master of how to properly use photo reference. So Green Arrow comes upon a riot in the streets. "My ever-loving mind. No, no. A hot summer day and a mob of men gone mad. Mostly black men." So it's a black neighborhood that Green Arrow stumbles upon. And you can see he gets hit. And a black kid tries to help him. He goes, "I'm sorry, I had to do something, but honest, I didn't know it was you." And then you get that image, which is Adams, the master cartoonist, not having to show you the bullet going into his head to make you feel that. Green Arrow rushes him into an ambulance. And then Elliot Magan quotes Hemingway's A Farewell to Arms. "If people bring so much courage to the world has to kill them to break them. So of course it kills them. The world breaks everyone. And afterward, many are strong in the broken places. But those that will not break, it kills. It kills the very good and the very gentle and the very brave impartially." Adams' choice to use a photograph in a degenerated Xerox form in the background gives his line art. And folks, if you think it's hard to draw a man crying? How about a man wearing a mask and crying, but crying out of anger and frustration, as only Neil Adams, a master, could pull it off? He created Green Arrow in 1969, 2 years prior, on this cover of the story of the team-up title, Brave and Bold. Every issue, Batman would meet another DC Comics hero. Of course, Batman was Neil Adams' other key recreation, just like he recreated Green Arrow. But in 1968, he would recreate Batman as the creature of the night, the Dark Knight that you know today. And this cover from 1972 is indicative of so many of the great Batman cityscapes. Again, it's Gotham City, but that's Adams' sense memory of New York City. He drew a great Christmas story in 1969, The Silent Night of the Batman, that opens with this evocative image of Gotham City on Christmas Eve and the hustle and bustle. And it ends with this Christmas morning, break of dawn image. For 2,000 years, mystics have experienced the many mysteries surrounding Christmas. Today, there is one more, The Silent Night of the Batman. If you've never read the story, folks, research it. You'll love it. Adams gave us some other great New York cityscapes with Batman during his 5-6 year run doing Batman at DC Comics. He created Man-Bat with the writer Frank Robbins, but that's maybe one of Adams' greatest covers. But man, so many great Batman covers. This was the second to last Batman story he would draw in 1973, but it was maybe the greatest Joker story ever told. Incredible artwork inside of it, but this cover has become iconic. That same year, the only artist to challenge Adams' vision of Batman in the city was the great Bernie Wrightson, the late great. But in this late fall issue of Swamp Thing in 1973, we get that beauty of a cover and Swamp Thing and Batman together. And it was in that issue we get one of the single greatest Batman drawings of all time that people still talk about, this single image engraved into everyone's mind with a pretty beautifully stylized city background as well. But man, you can feel the air billowing Batman's cape as only Bernie Wrightson could do it. Adams would go out on his solo Batman run with one last great story in the spring of 74 after that Wrightson Swamp Thing Batman team up with this story, Moon of the Wolf, that begins with a great opening splash page of Adams Chrysler Building in the background. And again, just beautiful attention to detail that makes you feel that Batman is climbing up on the roof of the adjacent building. And then just take the time to drink in this full page image so you can really decipher its magic, how Adams takes you down with Batman on the left side of the page, using the art of realism and cartooning, all of those swish marks and motion lines. Look at the time he takes to figure out the motion of the rope and how it would begin floppy and wind up taut, allowing Batman to swing down and then up through behind the two forefront panels and coming out on the top right of the page. And then, like a great film director, cuts to a medium shot establishing Batman and the girl on the roof. And then again, like a great film director, the intense close-up from below, the use of Zippitone in the background, the lighting, and the ability to draw Batman with his tongue in his cheek, like we've all done bringing that dialogue to life. Adam's longtime inker, Dick Giordano, would also pencil every now and then, as well as ink. This is one of his greatest Batman stories. After Adams kind of stopped drawing the character, this appeared in 1975, written by Denny O'Neill. But another nice cityscape there. And then in 1978, the late, great Marshall Rogers would debut on a series of about a dozen Batman stories written by Steve Englehart that are considered, you know, one of the greatest runs of Batman stories of all time. Again, if you haven't read it, it's been collected in multiple editions. But check out Rogers' splash page here. He had a background in architecture, I believe, educationally. And that's how he was able to make these beautiful drawings. Again, it's Gotham City, but that's your New York City landscape there. He ended his run on Batman with this full page image, very stylized. At around this time, mid 70s or so, well, this is actually 79, but earlier in the 70s, back in 1974, Will Eisner, who owned the Spirit, unlike most creators who didn't own the characters they drew for the companies, brought the Spirit back in the early 70s with James Warren of Warren Magazines. Here's a photograph of Eisner circa 1972, maybe. But in the full page new images he would do for the magazine periodically, it showed you that he never lost the step, that his rain-drenched central city of the Spirit was intact. Well, it was around this time, and we didn't find out till years later, that into each life, a little rain must fall. And we didn't find out this till years later, but Eisner and his wife's teenage daughter, sometime in the early 70s, died of leukemia. And I think Eisner kept it secret from only his like immediate family and friends. I don't think any fans knew about this, but years later, Eisner would cathartically channel that awful tragedy into his masterwork. What's considered the first graphic novel, 1978's A Contract with God. This is one of the many reprinted archival collections. It's all about this guy, Frimmy Hirsch, who comes home in the rain the day he buried Rachel, his daughter. A Contract with God is actually not a true graphic novel in the sense it's really a five or six short stories, but the lead story is about Frimmy Hirsch, who rails against God for not honoring his agreement. Hirsch felt he kept up his side by becoming a rabbi, by raising a beautiful daughter and being a good husband. And shouldn't God also be obligated? And so, that evening on the stoop of the tenement, Schloimi Krebs signed his name below that of Frimmy Hirsch, thereby entering into a contract with God. I guess Schloimi Krebs is his lawyer, her lawyer friend. A Contract with God was Eisner in this autobiographical image, channeling his experience of growing up in those New York City and Brooklyn tenements. And, you know, the primarily Jewish neighborhoods that he was a part of, where he would take stories like Kukulin, which was a kind of like a block party, but, you know, said in Yiddish, and all the names, the Fagel's Farm, these are all Yiddish Jewish immigrant names. One of the stories in A Contract with God is about the superintendent that lives below in the basement of the building. For years, if not decades after A Contract with God was published, Eisner would continue to do individual stories about his New York experiences, They were eventually collected in one big book, New York Life in the Big City. But you can see it's a collection of individual mini graphic, I call them novelettes, some, but you can see as an illustrator, he attempted in a single image to tell a story using the city itself as its foundation. So that you, the reader or the viewer, would fill in the story based on Eisner's mastery of cartooning. Again, with a combination of realism. He would give us the sights of the city as seen through his artistic eye, but you can feel the realism. He would give you the sounds of the city. You can hear the clackety clack of this train as it passes on the elevated, you know, right next to the building. If you've ever taken a train into Grand Central Station from the Hudson River line or the Metro North line, or taken it out of the city, you've experienced this. Yes, the smells of the city as well. Both the realistic smells and the smell of gentrification, as Eisner has his original tenants down below going, there goes the neighborhood. And perhaps Eisner was an influence on this New York City-based artist who would give us his cartoon versions of images that have a realism to them. They feel right. If you've been to downtown New York City, to what were once the Jewish neighborhoods of the Lower East Side that are now totally polyglot and mixed, this would be the work of the great Ben Katcher, New York City resident, who grew up fascinated with the city's old background. And he was proud to call himself the Jew of New York, because through his doppelganger, Julius Nipple, real estate photographer, unless that's a hard K, like Knish, I don't know, but I'm sure we can debate on that. But if you've been to New York City, especially if you've been downtown and to other parts of the boroughs, not just midtown tourist New York City, you can see why Katcher's Julius Nipple strips, while they're very cartoony, very hand-drawn, very primitive even, have a realism to them. Look at the three panels of the soda bottles and the water and the ice chest. I mean, again, if you've ever experienced that in real life, you have a sense memory of it, and Katcher's drawing feels real. These locations, they're based on memory and on Katcher's research, on photographs, but he draws them with a kind of almost surrealistic overlay that places them in a world both of his imagination, but one that's also based in a kind of realism. I lived in downtown New York City on Lafayette Street above Houston, where I swear there's a little island there that looks just like this beautiful panorama of Ben Katcher's. I lived in NoHo, where I believe these buildings are north of Houston. And that's why Katcher's vision of them in the carbon copy building cover has both a stylization and a reality to them. Here's a collection you can get of his great Julius Nipple real estate photographer strips. Beautiful cover illustration. At the same time, Julius Nipple and by proxy Ben Katcher were searching for New York City's soul through its old and ancient architecture. At the same time, in commercial superhero comics, Frank Miller's Daredevil was searching for his soul in the heart of Hell's Kitchen, where Frank Miller would set his Daredevil from the late 70s in 1978 up through 1983 or 4. His run on Daredevil reinvented the character and was totally based in the Vermont natives. He transplanted himself to New York City in the mid 70s, and his drawings in Daredevil totally placed New York City graphically front and center, as you can see by these images. I love this one of Daredevil hovering above the city, stylized, and stepping into the panel below. This would be a favorite compositional motif of Miller's, having the long vertical panel begin on the left side to give the feeling of almost like an exposition scene that he would then, again, like a great film director, come in for cuts. How about the beauty of this image? And by the way, his soulmate inker was Klaus Janson, that they're really an artistic collaboration, because it's Klaus Janson that's laying down all these beautiful black inks. But this is Miller, the designer, the art director, as well as, you know, the storyteller, penciler, using the city very graphically. Again, thin strips like film frames. I like his use of white paint, Klaus Janson's, and the way he inked the top panel to indicate the twinkling lights of nighttime New York. Janson's, I'm sure, colored this. He was a great colorist. The stylization of all yellow. Remember that printer that colored the yellow kid? Because yellow popped. That's why your eye is drawn to that top panel. And then he echoes it in the bottom right panel. How about this use of color holds in the second panel to get across that neon craziness of Times Square? Beautifully stylized, and yet it feels real. This is a beautiful triptych by Miller and Janson with some really nice coloring. And then how about that image that I used in my opening presentation? Interesting that Daredevil is saying it's so loud when Miller's giving you this beautiful cityscape inked by Janson. Miller would take his success on Daredevil in the early 80s and parlay that when he went over to DC to do the groundbreaking graphic novel split up into four prestige editions in 1986 and 87 called The Dark Knight Returns. And this would catapult back, and it didn't look like a regular comic, the use of typeset type versus hand-drawn type, at least on the cover, would signal to the mainstream reader this was not your father's or older brother's Batman comic. Miller's style throughout The Dark Knight Returns would be to use the city as the backdrop to the imagery consistently in a composition of silhouetting, also interacting with these TV screen inserts to get across the plot. But of course, it's about a aging, bulky, retired Batman coming out of retirement with a new Robin, a girl, young woman, I should say, Carrie, I forget her last name. But there's a very nice, again, with his partner, Klaus Janson, Miller does the city, the colorist, Lynn Varley. Miller likes to design with silhouettes a lot, but look at how he contrasts the silhouettes in the middle panel of Batman with the line art in the background. Nice, again, mixing up these beautiful shots of Batman and Robin gamboling, if I'm using that word right, B-O-L, across Gotham City's rooftops. How about this beautiful silhouette in the center of the page and how atmospheric that feels Again, it's Gotham City, but those are aerial shots of New York City. And then Miller and Jansen can put the entire background in silhouette, and yet your eye and your mind complete the city landscape in your imagination. This is a keynote image throughout The Dark Knight, the police headquarters building in the center of Gotham, towering above it with gargoyles at every, looks like 10 stories or so. And it was against this backdrop that Miller and Jansen would really go to town with black ink and silhouette to indicate lighting. I mean, that's a beautiful image forming the backdrop on the left. This is perhaps my single favorite Dark Knight image of all. And that's this promotional image that was used as a poster and eventually as a, I think, book cover for one of the collections. But that really weds Miller's vision of Batman with this very stylized vision of Gotham City. Here's Klaus Janson on his own, the same year Dark Knight came out, doing a cover for Detective Comics that really puts the city front and center graphically. So many great artists have taken on Batman. Boy, my spacer is jamming. What's going on here? Okay, we'll try this. So many great artists have taken on Batman and Gotham City, like Mike Zeck in 1988. I have this image as a miniature poster. It's so gorgeous. The next vision of Gotham City and Metropolis in comics would be the 1990 miniseries by writer Dave Gibbons and artist Steve Rude. Steve Rude is both a line artist as well as a painter. His signature character is Nexus, created in the early 80s with his partner, writer Mike Barron. But in 1990, he does the art on this miniseries, putting together his visions of Superman and Batman, which you can see Rude would always picture in terms of contrast. Superman is the character of light, of daytime, signifying the angel coming from the heavens. Batman is us, he's human. He comes from the darkness, from the depths. He's the yang to Superman's yin. In the same way, Metropolis is pictured by Rude in this double page spread as a city of dazzling golden sunlight. And then you have Gotham City, shown as the sun sets in the evenings. Rude would use black ink to fill in the borders of the pages between the panels to give his Gotham City environment a darker feel. Whereas his Metropolis pages with Superman are done in broad daylight with lots of white. Again, Gotham City in the clouds, nice bat signal. The final image of Metropolis in the series contrasted with the final image of Gotham City by Rude. The next significant image of Gotham City in Batman lore would be 1992's Batman the Animated Series against that red sky, created by the great Warner Brothers animator, Bruce Timm. In all of his production art, it was always that red sky and the stylized Batman. And his vision of Gotham City with his background artists like Eric Radomski in early production illustrations looked like this. In the actual cell animation art, it had this kind of feeling, which, yes, was somewhat inspired by Anton Furst, the late Anton Furst, and his production designs for the Gotham City of Tim Burton's first Batman film in 1989. Here's a film frame And here's one of Anton Furst's drawings that was used in creating that set. You can see that Furst himself was influenced by Fritz Lang's Metropolis. Some of Furst's drawings echo the feeling of Metropolis. Look at how DC Comics paid homage to Furst in this 1992 series, just as the animated series, right before, a year before the animated series would come out. And there's the actual Anton Furst image. Now, Anton Furst himself was influenced by the great American architect and illustrator, painter, designer, Hugh Ferris, who in the 1930s and 40s, he lived from 1889 to 1962. So in the 1930s, he created this collection of images called the Metropolis of Tomorrow. You can see in his studio that he made these paintings big, and his vision of the skyscrapers. Remember, Chrysler Building goes up in 1930, Empire in 1933. So Hugh Ferris is in the 1930s and early 40s doing images like this that connect the image of modern man with this colossus of stately, almost mirage-like images that Tim and his animators were able to achieve in their red sky images of Gotham City. Look at how this Hugh Ferris drawing was used by Bruce Timm in an early pitch to Warner Brothers on how they should do Batman, when all he does is add Batman to the Hugh Ferris illustration. Look at how the Batman animated animators were inspired by this Hugh Ferris illustration to create their drawing, which was then fully painted and ended up looking like this. When they packaged the animated version of The Dark Knight, this isn't Frank Miller's art, it's some anonymous illustrator. But you can see how this New York City feeling permeates the whole Dark Knight mystique. Bruce Timm not only was the master of this look, but he would inspire other artists who came to work for him at Warner Brothers Animation and then went off to have incredible careers of their own, like Darwin Cook, who in 2001 came to everybody's attention with a graphic novel called Batman Ego, which, as you can see by this cover image, has the red sky and the look of the Batman animated series. But that's because Darwin Cook went to work for Bruce Timm on Batman, the animated series. In this story about Bruce Wayne literally fighting it out with his ego as Batman, employing that Gotham City red sky in that center right panel. Darwin Cook would go on for the rest of his career. He unfortunately passed away about 5 years ago at the young age of 57. I mean, we lost a giant when we lost Darwin Cook, the creator of these incredible Batman images over the years, with his vision of the city always in sight. This reminds me of those Kirby. I mean, his drawing Batman here is very blocky like Kirby. And I think that's his homage to those Kirby buildings. But Cook could also do something as simply stylized as this and really make it sing. And so many modern comic artists, Jean-Paul Leon, who also just passed away this year at the age of 49, I believe. But man, was he a bright light when he was alive with images like this of Batman that would emphasize the background buildings of Gotham, aka New York City. I mean, so many beautiful images John Paul Leon created over the course of his, I'd say 25-year career, if not maybe a little longer. But man, talk about a picture's worth a thousand words. I mean, you can feel everything about this scene. It's like a miniature movie on the page. Look at how modern Batman artists like Yannick Paquette, this is a brand new cover he just executed and posted on Facebook that really plays off the graphic nature of Batman against the city backdrop. Here's how it appears with type and color. Here's David Latham doing a great Gotham City view with Batman graphically pictured in the center. Or upside down in the center, like this image I found on the internet, some random illustrator doing a real beautiful kind of view of Batman where you don't expect in an urban environment. But look at this cover of a beautiful recent graphic work. Chip Kidd is a book cover designer who usually uses illustration, but here he is as an artist illustrating his first Batman graphic novel, or writing it with Dave Taylor drawing it. I'm not sure who did the art, but you know, this brings up the more independent approach that DC has been allowing the past, I'd say since the turn of the century, and allowing independent artists to do their version of Batman. But then there's independent artists like Peter Cooper, New York City native, who has spent his multi-decade career drawn to New York. This is a not too long ago, collection of his great comic strips and comic book art, graphic novel work. This is the back cover. Through comics, illustrations, and sketches, Cooper captures everything from the low life to the high energy that has long made people from around the world flock to the Big Apple. Drawn to New York is a reflection of one artist's 30 years on 12 miles of island with 8 million people in a city whose story is ever being written. There's a nice shot of Peter in the New York City subway. Here's an early strip of his where you can see he would draw himself autobiographically into it, but always with New York City as a setting in the background. This is one of his illustrations I used in my opening visual, the visual opening of tonight's presentation. Always with the mixture of the city, bringing the city to life in graphic, almost cartoonish ways that nevertheless maintain an eerie realism. Mad Magazine, about 20 years ago, was looking for a new artist to do Spy versus Spy, their long-running strip that had been running for decades by Prohias. Not sure if I'm pronouncing his name right. But this was Cooper's presentation piece, I believe, using New York City landscapes that got him the gig. And he's been doing it, I don't know if ever for 20 years, but this is a recent issue from spring of 2021 where he gets to do the cover of it. But 20 years ago in the spring of 2001, Cooper did some incredible illustrations of the tragedy that made you feel it like this. And this. Drawn to New York is filled with his sequential panel strips, a great encounter on New York City one rainy night, and this little sequence of the lifespan of a movie theater, life, birth, and rebirth. I particularly love the single page illustration that kind of encapsulates what many people feel New York City in the end is all about, but I love its ragtag, colorful image of New York City life. And that's something that the Brooklyn-based artist Dean Haspiel achieves in his comic works that are basically torn from the pages of the Brooklyn neighborhoods that he lives in. This is his signature character, the Red Hook. We're going to talk about him in a little bit. But you can see early on in his career that Haspiel would use New York City as his background, as his backdrop. He lived in both Manhattan, but I think the last 25 years he's been in Brooklyn. And these are stories of his life experience done in his quirky, idiosyncratic style. Haspiel would also illustrate other people's stories, like Jonathan Ames and his almost self-portrait as an alcoholic. And Haspiel would use real Brooklyn locations to bring the story to life. He could be a hired gun and work for the comic companies, like this series that he illustrated with the Marvel writer and DC writer Mark Waid, an adventure character called the Fox. The Fox was created decades before by one of the giants in the medium, Alex Toth. But you can see that Haspiel jumped at the chance to do a modern take on the Fox and use the Fox as an inspiration for his own character of late, the Red Hook, Brooklyn super thief, dated 2016. Haspiel kicks off the series that he calls New Brooklyn. And that's all about how Brooklyn said here, most people ignored the warning signs while pundits posited that Brooklyn gave up or called it quits. They were only half right. And as the Red Hook is trying to get away, remember, he's, for some reason, he's a criminal, but you can see the ground ruptures from beneath him. There were rumors that the heart of Brooklyn was broken, wounded by a self-entitled, indifferent society, spoiling the promise of a better tomorrow. That day, Brooklyn shrugged and challenged humanity to return back to a time when people were defined by their ethics, values, and contributions. A dawn where guardians would be born to supervise a new era. A new Brooklyn. A new republic that could protect itself and exploit the fruits of new ideas and conquer new problems and new villains with new heroes, by crook or by hook. The Red Hook. One of the climactic images of the series. This one, pregnant with meaning. The Red Hook's gone on to some acclaim, being voted best webcomic. Haspiel continues to turn out storyline after storyline with different characters. I love this one. The Purple Heart continues to erect a life-sustaining shield made from the power of New Brooklyn's art, insisting that art is life. And Haspiel's art, which brings to life so many great Brooklyn and New York City locations in his series, New Brooklyn, which I believe makes a fitting end here in the 21st century at the dawn of a new era post-pandemic, that I bring my webinar to a close of New York City in comics. Images of the city and comic art history. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This is one of my many comics history projects. If you go to my website, arlenschumer.com, you'll find this page. It's filled with a lot of my multimedia articles and exhibits, and it's linked to my book site where you can get a signed and sketched in by me copy. It's the only book of its kind that's about the art of the 1960s. And I take out the original dialogue and put the artist talking about the art. So you read it like a giant comic book, but it's an art book and a history book. I run a Facebook group on the Silver Age, one on Jack Kirby, and one dedicated to Neil Adams. My biggest influence in my own illustration work, doing comic book art, but for advertising and editorial usage. One of my specialties is called Finding Your Inner Superhero, where I maintain the photographic likeness, but merge it with the look of comic book art. I'm on the TeePublic merchandise site where you can get over 125 of my illustrations and every knickknack, Igor, thingamabob, and tchotchke you could think of. My own merchandise site, link from my website, Pop Culture Man, is exclusively posters. A lot of the images that are not on TeePublic are on my poster site. I continue to do these webinars and visual lectures that I used to call what I did live pre-pandemic, that you can see videos on my YouTube channel, link from my website, along with more recent videos of my webinars that I've been doing since the pandemic shutdown. Coming up next week on a Wednesday, the 23rd, let me get my calendar out. I will be doing the fourth of my James Bond free webinar series. Yes, on the 23rd, on Thunderball, the fourth film. Then on Friday the 25th, the Shin Gallery in downtown Manhattan on the Lower East Side, not too far where Jack Kirby grew up, is having an exhibit of the paintings of Frank Robbins. Now, you might recognize the name Frank Robbins if you're a comic book fan, because in the late 60s, he wrote and also drew for DC Comics many Batman stories. And then he left comics in 1978 and painted the rest of his life. Passed away in 1994. But I was there last Saturday, and I talked him into letting me do this lecture in the gallery next week on the 25th about the comic art of Frank Robbins. Then for New York Adventure Club, which I've been doing webinars with, if you go to nyadventureclub.com, the following Tuesday, I'll be doing a webinar on the great story of John Henry, the model for the modern American superhero. On the last day of June, Wednesday the 30th, for free, my comic book artists of the Silver Age series, basically all the characters and artists in my book. But on the 30th, I'll be reprising my Spider-Man Ditko versus Romita, Who Did It Better webinar. And then for New York Adventure Club on Friday, July 2nd, just in time for July 4th, my double whammy of Kirby and Steranko's Captain America. If you go to my website, to the events blog page, I always post all of my upcoming events at least a couple days in advance, where you can get links to everything you need to come see my webinar. So thank you again, ladies and gentlemen, for attending this webinar, and I hope to see you further on up the road. Bye-bye.
Thanks for attending this presentation. Hope you enjoyed it. And please remember to click the subscribe or follow button on your platform screen to be notified of all of my upcoming pop culture presentations. And visit my website, arlenschumer.com, to sign up for my newsletter too. Until next time, I'm Arlen Schumer. Bye-bye.